It's working. Okay. Hello to my first talk, the first talk I do ever. I'm a bit nervous. This talk is meant to be and explain a little bit how to boot successfully for the first time with.
Sorry, we cannot hear you. A bit louder, please.
A bit louder? Okay. This talk is meant to be how to boot a bit successfully for the first time with mainline. I can tell you that there is no secret to do this. The only thing that you need to do is start working with mainline at the earliest stage of the development. My name is Enric, and I'm an electronic engineer, and I'm a hardware and Linux enthusiast, kernel contributor, and I have more than 5 years of experience bringing up different kinds of boards, mainly animal boards. I did also the bring up of some TI boards like OMAP 3, OMAP 4, OMAP 5, and also some from FreeScape. In this talk, I want to introduce what is board bring up for those that maybe don't know. And then also I will explain the process involved to develop a new board from the hardware side and to the software side. And I will try to explain the problems I see that sometimes in this development happens, and how mainline can help us to improve this process. And at the end, I will try to expose some lessons learned. So what's board bring up? For those that don't know, board bring up is the process of validating both electrically and functionality, and is a new circuit board design, including the porting of the boot firmware and the development of a board support package. This process sometimes takes so long, and sometimes your product never gets to the market because fails in this stage. To start developing a new board, the first step is make the hardware, as probably you know. The first step is make the specifications, but when you start to developing the hardware, you need to, at the first moment, start with the component selection. Basically here what you do is select the different components that you need to fit your requirements. As a second step, there is you need to make a circuit design that is called the schematic. Normally you have an schematic page for every block of your design. Then you need to generate the bill of materials, also called BOOM. This is normally it's auto-generated by the schematic software, so it's not a problem. It's a list of the different parts and the different options that you can fit. Then you need to make the PCB prototypes. And this is a two-steps process, because the first time you need to create the bare printer board, and next you need to solder all the components onto the board. And finally, there is the certification. The certification depends on the country, and generally is not done at the first stage of, or at the first prototypes, is maybe done later, no? When you have the final product, or you are close to the final product. Once this is done, starts the work for the software engineer or the software team. And the software team generally what does is do the firmware programming if there is some microcontroller. They also take care about the bootloader, the kernel, and the device drivers, of course. Then need to define the software stack, and finally the application development that fits all in your new product. So what's the problem with this process? So the problem with this process is that you're sometimes, or the hardware team produces a first prototype, then gives this prototype to the software team. The software team found some errors that are hardware related, so reports the bug, goes to the hardware team, does a board spin, and then you have the software testing again. You found another bug that it's a hardware problem, and you need to do another spin. The thing is that if you plan it 2 or 3 spins of the board, always you have 3 or 4 more spins. So there is people here that is doing hardware or is more, yeah? And has this ever happened to you? Yes, it's very usual to do the spins, and sometimes even when you are at the end of the product, it's the time that arrives the marketing team and says, okay, but I need to do this. Please, it's a small change, but you need to do another spin to accomplish the marketing team. If this ever happened to you, this is very normal. This happens. And if not, you are my hero. But I think there is no heroes here. And then the next question is how we can do this. So what I saw in my years of experience is that the work between the hardware team and software team, they not work together. They work together only at the latest stage. So the suggestion is introduce the software team at the earliest stage of the development. What does it mean, this? And the big question is how mainline can help us to improve this process. I think that the software team must be introduced in the whole design of the whole design process of a product from the beginning. But for time, I want to talk on these two phases, the component selection and the circuit design schematic, and explain a little bit how the software design can help the hardware team to do better this phase. So, in the component selection of the board, the principle that you need to decide is the main processor. In this step, it's very important that PGA. So the SOC is sending twice the width per the head and the FPGA controls directly which part goes to the display to up, which part goes to the display to down. And how fits this on, from the software point of view? From the software point of view, you have, in the first example, you have that the application sends the image to the frame buffer 0 or to the frame buffer 1. And you need a kernel driver to control this. The kernel driver normally is the same. It's just that it's two instances. So there is one instance for the frame buffer 0 and one instance for the frame buffer 2. Then you need the firmware of the microcontroller. You need to do this. And then there is the displays. If you choose the second option, in this case, you only have one frame buffer. You also need, of course, a kernel driver. The kernel driver communicates with the FPGA, so you also need to program the bit stream of the FPGA, and that controls the two displays. So in this case, what's the difference? The software is the same. You need to do two kernel drivers, you need to program the microcontroller, and you need to program the FPGA. Well, the difference is that the kernel driver in the second case is probably that you don't need to do. But the kernel driver for the first case, you need to do because it's your custom. Is your custom solution. In the second case, you can get the kernel driver from the SOC and directly send twice the width and the height of the display and send to the FPGA, and the FPGA is transparent, so sends the image correctly to both displays. So at this point, I told you that there are different steps. So the first step was the circuit design. I think that the software team must be involved in the review of the schematic. That means that maybe the software team or some parts of the software team must need some hardware skills, or can be the contrary. The one of the hardware team needs to know a little bit or more about the kernel and how it works. Yes, at this point also it's important, even you don't have the hardware, that you can start writing the device tree file. This is architecture specific, but most probably you already know that on most TAN boards, you need to create a device tree file to specify how the hardware is connected between. And this is important because when you when you define the hardware in this file, you can catch some errors that are made in the schematic phase. Some pins that are wrong, or some pins that does the functionality that it's not expected. You can also configure properly the muxer settings of the pins or the pin controller, and you need to take care about how to enable the integrated circuits. You need to take care about the enable of the different regulators of the board, because it's possible that if you don't enable one regulator, the board doesn't start. And you also can tell the hardware team if some pull-ups or pull-downs are not needed, because is the same shock also provides him. Most of pull-ups and pull-downs sometimes are only needed before the software starts or before the kernel starts. But then you can use the internal pull-ups. So what I learned during these years. So the first thing that I must say is that there is one rule that is the main rule, that is always try to upstream first. Even you don't have the hardware, even you don't have the hardware, you can find solutions to try to develop a driver that you need for your design, and you can try to upstream. In this case, when you upstream, you get feedback, and there is a whole community that is reviewing your patches, and you know that you are doing the things well. In all stages, work as close to mainline at early stage of of the development. Review the schematic from the software point of view always. As I told you, you can catch prototypes. So how more bugs catch in the early development process, you less respins you will need to do at the end. And the most important, well, not the most important, but one thing that is don't play ping pong and work together. What I want to say with this is that I saw a lot of times that when there is a problem in your hardware or in your software, there is always a battle between the hardware team and the software team saying, no, it's your fault, no, it's your fault, and there is a ping pong and never claims to the solution. So work together. Work together and try to investigate this problem together, and well, that's all. And yeah, well, that's all. So, any questions or? 3 minutes? Can you repeat a bit?
In my experience, you have a few software, a few hardware engineers, more software engineers. Management see it's easier to fix some software, so they don't care about anymore. They just get taken a vendor issue.
Yeah. Fortunately, I think that this is changing a little bit, and lots of vendors are trying to push upstream more things. But even your vendor doesn't care about pushing upstream things, or is using an old VSP or an old software, working upstream or working with, try to boot mainline and working upstream is better because you have behind a huge community that can help you to do the things well and to help you to develop the your product. Yes, yes, yes. Yes, always you need to consider if one solution is cheaper or not, but sometimes what happens is that people don't know that software is not cheaper. So sometimes develop something in software has also a lot of costs. So yeah, it depends on the scale.
Yeah. See if it doesn't tie all together, adding extra controllers.
Mm-hmm. Wow. Time. Okay. Thank you.